Okay, let's get serious. Tejkaran asked me about a speaker advice, that he has a very nice set of speakers and he is not really satisfied with them, and he suspects that the crossover has some issues in it. Maybe he can adjust the crossover, and his worry is that his speakers use pro drivers and maybe they are not good enough for audiophile purposes. So let's have a look at the drivers first and the cabinet volumes. He also gave me the cabinet volumes, and let's see what we can learn from that and give advice on it. So actually this is the woofer that he uses, a Beyma 18 inch woofer, and it's an absolutely gorgeous driver. It's as beautiful, as good as it gets. So it's an 18 inch diameter, and it means that it's just huge. So if you look at my Altex, these are 15 inch drivers, so it's like this. So that driver would be about that big. So if you see that inner rim there, this driver would be that size. So it can move tremendous amount of air, and it can handle up to 900 watts of power. So it has a lot of headroom to it, and eventually it can handle that much continuous power. Because when you use it for pro use, then you can like sustain 120 dB plus output, like for a concert at a constant level. So that's basically the qualification for pro use, that it can handle very high level of output continuously. And actually that's something that makes it more than an audiophile driver, because audiophile drivers cannot usually handle that high output for that long time. But nowadays there's a shift, so now we are seeing these heavy duty woofers popping up in the most expensive segments of the audiophile speakers as well. But until recently this was not typical, and it was only the domain of pro drivers. And because it's 18 inch, it has a 4.5 inch edge wound copper voice coil, so its voice coil is quite thick in diameter. But what's really fantastic, that it's edge wound copper voice coil, which is the same as in the Altec driver. So it's as good as it can get. It has a dual spider configuration, so the spider, that's the element that holds it in place at the bottom. So it means that it's dual, so it's doubled up to make sure that it doesn't flex and doesn't move. And where I cannot read it, but it has cloth surround, ribbed cloth surround at the edge, which is absolutely phenomenal. That's the best material you can get for audiophile purposes. And here they use the cloth surround because that has the least loss. So then they can up the power output without much distortion. But in most audiophile speakers, they use the drivers, they use instead that plastic surround that has that blip, that has that lip in it. And that's a much lower grade material than this. I have in a previous video all about that, what's the difference between this type of surround and the blip surround. This is way superior. So this is just a fabulous driver. So usually people watch videos of other people posting videos of their systems and in a showroom or somewhere, and I just drool about. That kind of stuff leaves me totally cold. I have zero interest in that, but this gets me excited. This is the real deal, because from here I can get ideas. You can learn about stuff, and I can apply them for my own betterment or how to plan a system. So now let's look at the output curves, the frequency response curve, and here we see that it's about almost like 100 dB between like 150 hertz and about a kilohertz, and then there's a peak. So it peaks between a kilohertz and 1.5 kilohertz, and that peak is about like a 5 dB peak, and then it rolls off. So the roll off is because of the inductance of the voice coil, because you have a huge voice coil, so the voice coil diameter is big. And it means that it's going to have a lot of inductance. If you make the voice coil tiny, like for example in the case of a 6-inch driver, it will have a very little inductance. So then this roll off is not going to roll off that much. So because you have that huge voice coil, it acts as a first order crossover, and you see this nice slope that is really something like a crossover added to this. And you see the cone break up here in this region, which corresponds to 3, 4, 4.5K and above. Then we have the nasties. So basically you want to avoid the 4K plus region with this driver. And the rest is just the voice coil inductance kicking in. And it has this interesting peak here and around 1 to 1.5k. And the reason for that is the dust cap. So you see the dust cap diameter that defines that frequency. And that's from where it starts acting up. And you see we have this cone here that acts as a horn. So frequency is above below 1 kilohertz or so can be amplified really nicely and evenly by this driver. And when we hit that kilohertz range, which corresponds to the wavelength of the dust cap, then we are start to have that extra boost, because you see there, it starts acting like a double cone. So like it's here and there, it's kind of like a V shape in the center. So that adds a little extra boost to those frequencies. So when you design a crossover for that, you want to design it such that the cut starts to happen at here, like a first order cut or a second order cut. And that as your crossover starts to cut it more, the driver wants to work more, and you can even it out, flatten out this peak until 1.5 kilohertz. So to mate it well, then either if you want to make it work to a high frequency range to about a kilohertz, then you can use that peak to incorporate it into your crossover and then flatten it out. Or you can just avoid it altogether and cross it over like here or somewhere there, even lower, and just get rid of the whole thing altogether, because by the time you reach there, its response is so low that it doesn't contribute anything to the sound. What else do we have here? You see it's 98 dB efficient, so the sensitivity is just given as a number here, and they also put a 2π space was the measurement that was used to define the sensitivity, and this you never see in an audiophile setting. This is more, this is giving you more information, which is a super good sign, but this is just a number. When you look at the frequency response, this measurement, this tells you exactly what's going on. And you see we have like 100 dB sensitivity around a kilohertz, and then 1.5 kilohertz or so, or a little less, maybe 1.3, we have 105 dB sensitivity, and when you go there, it rolls off. But this is natural. Doesn't matter how big your driver is, under 200 hertz, under 150, it's going to roll off anyway. Now, because of the extreme size of this woofer, it starts to roll off below 100 hertz. But if you have like smaller ones, they start to roll off around 150 or so. So anyway, let's go back. And here, so they recommend to use it to 1.5 kilohertz. And I would say, you see, at 1.5 kilohertz, you already have that blip here. And then from there, it starts to drop. And if you use it for professional use, for pro use, so you want to use it for a concert, then this is okay, like having a peak there, no worries. But if for audiophile purposes, this is going to be bothersome in your music. So that's why you want to cut the crossover here. And when these blips add to it, then you can flatten out until 1.5K, and then you will start to see a more sudden roll off. So it would work really nice if we use it up to that frequency. However, while people, even in pro use, do not use it up to 1.5K, but mate it with a mid-bass, mid-range driver, is because when you add a driver to work the mid-range frequencies, then you can sustain 120 dB plus volumes more easily, because your woofer has to work a more limited frequency range. It means that much less of the music power is going to your woofer, so you can crank it higher. However, if you have a home setting, you have a reasonable size room that you are using it, like a living room, if it's like 100 square meters or less, even like 100 square meters, it's a gigantic room. But even in that size room, you do not really need an extra mid-bass driver to help out, because you are not going to use that high sound pressure levels. So let's go back here, and they say recommended enclosure volumes 80 to 200 liters. So that's what they recommend. And as we see, it's a gorgeous, fantastic woofer. So I can really so one more interesting detail, the resonant frequency is 36 hertz. So it means that this driver wants to work happily down to around 30 hertz or so. And if you use this recommended volume, that 200 liter, then it will be happy down to 30 hertz. But if you increase the cabinet volume, it can play lower and lower. However, there's one price to pay for a higher cabinet volume, is that the sound will become slower and slower. So that might be an issue, because if it's slower, then it will lose the feel of dynamics and freshness, and it will compromise your higher frequency output, like 30 plus hertz output. And even though you get more material between 20 hertz and 30 hertz, but that's a really a much lower benefit compared to ruining your 30 hertz plus material. So like, you're gaining 5% plus at the cost of making the 95% worse. And you see the displacement volume is 1 liter. So as the cone moves, it can push 1 liter of air. That's just absolutely monstrous. And look, they specify the absolute efficiency as well, 2.5%. So it means that 2.5% of the music signal is turned into voice, and that's absolutely phenomenal. So this is just a wonderful driver, and I would recommend it wholeheartedly. And if I were to start with building a speaker for myself, I would gladly choose this driver. And look, the price tag that goes with it, this is insanely cheap. This is excellent price for this quality. I know that if you are just starting out building your first pair of speakers, this is a little bit too much. But if you are about to build your ultimate last final speaker at the end of a long audiophile journey, go with this. I can really recommend that. So now let's look at the compression driver that goes with it, and that's another Beyma. And do I have the name of it? That's the one that Tej Karan uses, and both of these are 8 ohm drivers. And this is a compression driver. And let's look what it can do. So it has a 1.4 inch throat diameter, which is the same as my Altec 288 compression driver. And let's see, it can handle program material about 100 watts or so. Sensitivity is 110 dB, which is just, when you compare it to regular tweeters, it's just off the charts. And its frequency range is 600 hertz to 20 kilohertz. And they recommend to cross it over at 800 hertz or higher. And they recommend that because when you add a horn to a compression driver, under a kilohertz, you are usually going to see problems with the behavior. And that's partly because of the horn roll-off, the horn's properties, but when you go under 800 hertz, under 700 hertz, these get more and more striking. So, and also when you add the horn, the horn's efficiency is between 1 kilohertz to 3 kilohertz, so that's where they are most efficient. So that's why you want to avoid the region that's under 1 kilohertz when you attach a horn to the compression driver. Here I'm running it, the horn the compression driver without a horn, and I can get away by using it down to 500 hertz because I do not have that horn distortion, and there's no extra blip for the 1 to 3 kilohertz region. So actually, Tej Karan, you can also experiment if you want that. Instead of putting a horn on this driver, just use it bare. If you can mount it on top of your speaker like this and have it fire it up. And you see, because the base is this shape, cone shape, like build a structure around it to make it straight so that the sound waves do not curl back underneath. Because you want the top of your speaker to act as the buffer for your compression driver. So as the sound goes up, the top of your speaker is the support for it. So that will act as if, let me just draw it here. So let's imagine that this is the top of your speaker. Kind of hard to draw with one hand. And you put the compressor driver on the top. So it's facing upwards, and it looks like this is your speaker baffle. But instead of facing it towards you, it faces upwards. And this top of your speaker driver will help to support frequencies with your cabinet size down to about 400 hertz. So you could push your compression driver even down to 500 hertz if you want to make it work lower than it does. And but why would you do that? I will tell that a little bit later. But now, for now, I'm just telling it that this compression driver would work down to about 500 hertz if need be. However, it has a titanium diaphragm, and titanium doesn't really like below 1 kilohertz range, or certainly below 800 hertz range. So maybe I would recommend just making it work down to a kilohertz. So here in my compression driver, which is almost the exact same thing as yours, I have a aluminum diaphragm, and that is more happy to work in the mid-range. So I can make it work down to 500 hertz, and it's really happy. Titanium does not have that nice mid-range. It will have a drier mid-range. So you will be happier using your woofer to work up to about a kilohertz. So let's see. What else can we glean for this information? 1.9 Tesla flux density. So it means that its motor is just as strong as it can get. Now the highest I've seen is just a little over 2 Teslas. And basically you are getting, this is one of the most efficient drivers you can get. This is like having a Ferrari compared to the other speakers, drivers, which are even like in a Wilson Audio, that's like a Hyundai Elantra's engine compared to that. So now let's look at your mid-range driver, and let's just scroll it up. So that's a Faital woofer. It's also an 8-ohm driver, and it's also a pro driver, and it's a 10-inch driver, and it has 96 dB sensitivity. So it's a little less than your woofers and a lot less than the compression driver, and it can help out between 50 to almost 5 kilohertz. And it's actually a pretty nice driver, and it has the same kind of surround as your woofer does, and it's a gorgeous little 10-inch woofer. I call it little because it's compared to an 18-inch, it's little. But it's not the same quality as the Beyma. It has a stamped steel frame, and the Beyma had a cast steel frame, so the Beyma's frame is of much higher quality. And here we are also seeing the cloth accordion surround, the same as in the Beyma, and just looking at that, and check out the price that you can buy this driver. So if you are thinking about building your first pair of speakers, this is for my general audience, then this is an absolutely gorgeous driver to start up with, and it works up to almost 5 kHz, so you can mate it up, let's say something like with a Fostex T90A super tweeter, and it will give you a phenomenal speaker, and I will go into that. I will make a future video coming up with a little preliminary plans on how to make a speaker with that. However, let's see, let's go if I have any more details on that. It can handle 300 watts of power, so it means that it takes a lot of music in. However, let's see now that we have these three drivers. So we have a compression driver that's happy to work down to about 800 hertz. We have a mid-range that's happy between 50 to 5 kilohertz. And we have a woofer that's happy between 25 hertz to 1.5 kilohertz. And in a professional setting, you need all three. And when you have all three, you can play continuous 120 dB plus. However, is there a downside to that? Yes, there is. And the downside is that the more complex your system is, the more phase issues you are going to get in the sound. So if you are adding three drivers, then you have phase problems between the transition of these two and between the transition of that two. And it's going to make your crossover not just twice as hard, but exponentially harder to design. And in this case, you see the compression driver can work down to 800. The woofer can work up to twice of that. So you can just use these two and take out. You do not need the mid-range for an audiophile setting. And of course, there's a reason to use it even in an audiophile setting. If you have a three-way, then because the brunt of the music, about 80% of that signal that your ear processes will come from the mid-range. So this will define the sonic characteristic of your speaker. And then, because it carries the mid-range, the woofer can work on the lowest frequencies with better efficiency, because it doesn't need to go up to a kilohertz or so. So technically, your lower bass will be better if you have three drivers. But practically, it will not be better, because the mid-range is not nearly as good as it could be. And that's because, even though this is a nice driver, and if I would recommend a speaker to build, I would use it with this driver and another tweeter, but that would be like a mid-level speaker build. But these two drivers are way higher quality than that. It's like comparing, let's say, a good Renault with a Bentley. So this is like putting a Renault engine in a Bentley. It is going to completely ruin the performance. And not because the Renault is a bad car, but it's not in this league. So I would take out the mid-range from your speaker and just use these two and mate them. And that will give the advantage of simplifying the crossover, so you do not have a crossing in the mid-bass that mucks up the mid-bass. You do not have something that mucks up the transition between mid-range and high frequencies. So you have a much more whole sound with a way improved harmonic and textural information. The only price to pay is that you cannot use it in a pro setting. So if you have a concert of 1,000 people, it will not work there anymore, but it will work much better in your home. And let's just make it quick, because now we are really pushing almost half an hour now. You know what, let's make that in a second video, that there's another reason why we need some adjustment here with your speaker cabinet before we look at the crossover. And let's explore it in the second part. Thank you. Bye-bye.